Ladies and gentlemen, and others, citizens, sinners, taxpayers, and dog eaters, and Puerto Ricans, and deplorables, and weirdos, patriots, and wooks, and racists, and the woke. Welcome to the special exclusive End of the World Party 2024 United States of APAC Presidential Board of Directors Executive Election National Series Finale Coverage Special Podcast. In the red corner, rich kid billionaire, 45th President of the United States, and clan favorite Donald Tiny Hands Trump. And in the blue corner, Vice President Officer Kamala Holocaust Harris, former Senator of the former state of California. For those of you who have been living under a rock or stranded by a hurricane or evading a genocide for the past few months, President Joe Biden was tragically found dead on the debate stage this summer. Vice President Kamala Harris was naturally chosen by party insiders to take his place. Of course, only after being dismissed by the same party insiders because of her seeming inability to win a national election, but a real Democratic contest in the Democratic Party would have been a total scorched earth clusterfuck of all the craven, ambitious, self-seeking parasites that would have been fighting for the nomination. So she got the job 3 months before the general election. As any candidate or career political pundit will tell you, there's a lot at stake in this election. Like what color the Gaza genocide will
be. Blue or purple, take your pick.
If The Handmaid's Tale becomes a documentary. If the representative democracy that the billionaires and party insiders have crafted for us will survive. And not that anyone cares, but this is our last chance to deal with global warming. According to the UN IPCC, the window to avoid global climate catastrophe will close during the next administration. And the UN is very serious about this, guys. This time is for real. This is for real the last chance. The window is seriously closing this time, guys. So, existential crisis. Existential
crisis. Please note that the reason that you do not see any End of the World Party candidates on your ballot is because the End of the World Party is the only party on the ballot. So we can't lose. And by lose, I mean win.
So now let's take a look at what the leading contenders in this charade have to say about the most serious and difficult problem that mankind has ever faced.
Well, the former president had said that climate change is a hoax.
All of this with the global warming and that, and a lot of it's a hoax.
No question I'm in favor of banning fracking. We have to just acknowledge that the residual impact of fracking is enormous in terms of the impact on the health and safety of communities.
It's a hoax. I mean, it's a money-making industry, okay?
He intends to surrender our fight against the climate crisis.
Do you still want to ban fracking?
No, and I made that clear on the debate stage in 2020 that I would not ban fracking. As vice president, I did not ban fracking. As president, I will not ban fracking.
Our numbers on air are tremendous.
No question I'm in favor of banning fracking. So, yeah, and starting with what we can do on day one around public lands, right?
The liquid gold that we have under our feet, liquid gold, it's oil and gas, sometimes referred to as oil and gas.
I was the tie-breaking vote on the Inflation Reduction Act, which opened new leases for fracking.
Really clean coal.
We have also increased domestic gas production to historic levels.
Our numbers are very, very good. Our environmental numbers.
Oh, dear God. Oh, fuck. Well, speaking of historic levels of environmental numbers, last year broke the record for both carbon emissions, atmospheric CO2 and methane concentrations, and annual increase in concentrations. Carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is at a level the planet hasn't seen in 4 million years. Methane levels are at a level you haven't seen in a million years, more than doubled since pre-industrial times. At this point, 2024 is almost certain to be the hottest year on record. And on a totally related note, this U.S. general election is set to break election spending records. And on yet another totally related note, the world currently has a record number of refugees, which, if you haven't noticed, is having a major impact on politics all over the world, primarily by boosting nationalism, xenophobia, and Trump-style faux populist fascism.
They're eating the dogs.
Which is, of course, the sworn enemy of liberals everywhere, and yet, where are Democrats on connecting this? Like, I don't know if I've ever heard, maybe once, it's a mere mention when you're talking about immigration, which is one of the biggest issues of this election. Climate change is almost never mentioned when it should be
mentioned every time.
Democrats are burying their own lead here. Like, but, you know, at the end of the day, do they give a fuck? I don't know. I mean, like what we just heard, Republicans deny the science,
And Democrats believe in the science, whatever that means, but they just don't give a fuck. Is that better or worse?
You know what? If you want Donald Trump to win, then say that, otherwise I'm speaking.
So I know that a little later on this year, you're going to have another one of those really swell presidential elections that you like so much. You'll enjoy yourselves. It'll be a lot of fun. I'm sure as soon as the election is over, your country will improve immediately.
Now let's take a look at the Electoral College scoreboard. We'll start with the great swing state of Pennsylvania. Just kidding. Not gonna do that corporate media horse race bullshit. This is the whole problem with our fucking political system. This two-party system that we have, it makes it like a sports game for us. And that's something Americans can relate to, a sports game. And that's not great when you want critical thinking, especially at a time like this in history, faced with global warming and ecological collapse, which are genuinely difficult problems. We've got the system with two parties and two sports teams, and we just go head-to-head like this. It's like everyone in this country's, at least everyone who votes, you know, is stripped off their shirt on a 20-degree day, painted themselves either blue or red, and, you know, they're spelling out one letter, either Harris or Trump, screaming at each other all drunk in the fucking freezing hail of some Midwest swing state. And this is not a way that we can solve these problems. We need critical, serious, somehow collective, public, critical thinking about the most difficult problem that humanity's ever faced. Let's be real, we faced climate change before, almost went extinct, but people just adapted and survived in the animal way. We didn't know any, we weren't causing that, you know, and the climate change we've caused so far has worked out great for us, but we're at that breaking point. We've adapted to the cold. We've never adapted to the heat. So yes, we've adapted to climate change, as climate deniers love to say when they, you know, they keep running out of arguments. We've adapted to climate change as a species before, but it was always on the colder side. And it almost wiped us out a few times. You can set a fire. You can't set a cold. If it's like you're in a deadly heat wave, heat death is coming for you, you can't just set a cold. I mean, you can have a refrigerator running, you can have your AC running, but, you know, once the weather gets really out of control and knocks the grid out at a time like that, then, you know, if you can't survive 6 hours in that kind of heat, well, you can't survive 6 hours. And we have no idea even how hot it's going to get. And this, we're already at, so many of our systems are at a breaking point. And this empty tribalism is why we can't think. We can't think about anything. We can't think about the genocide in Gaza. We can't think about climate change. We can't think about fixing anything. And the pundits and the educated liberal elite love to go on about polarization in this country, but they will never accept during a campaign season that the core of the polarization in this country comes from our bipartisan politics and how they doesn't work for anyone but the rich.
I mean, it's a money-making industry, okay?
And a lot of the dynamic of this problem comes down to the desire to win. The, you know, electoral victory becomes the altar that we sacrifice human progress on. I used to be involved in politics a lot, and I'd hear over and over from people not campaigning according to what they truly believe. Obviously, campaigning to the right is what I'm insinuating here. And they would defend that by saying that they had to win first before they could change anything for the better. And this is the perpetual excuse that you'll hear, specifically among Democrats, that they have to get elected and then they can do what's right. And then they can stand up for what's right. And the problem is, once you get elected, then what? You have to get reelected. So it's the same dynamic perpetuates itself, and they never can stand up for what they truly know and believe to be right and what they know to be reality. And especially when it comes to climate change, they won't stand up for what they know is the reality on climate change because of this cynicism and the desire to win just the next election. What's lost, apparently, on Democrats and especially, you know, also on the left and progressives is the opportunity that campaigns provide. They give you the type of public exposure that it takes millions and millions, sometimes billions of dollars to buy. I mean, how much money has been spent on, say, AOC and her campaigns compared to how much airtime she's gotten, how much exposure she's gotten, whether you, you know, disagree or agree whatever about her, whatever, whatever. But grassroots, progressive, knocking doors, the real populist electoralism, and the attention that gets from the media during election times, and especially for incumbents and the major parties. They all focus on winning when they have this opportunity, when they... So part of this excuse comes down to, you know, a real condescending notion of campaigning versus governance, that Democrats, candidates, they love to, politicians love to act like campaigning and governing are two very different things. But the reality is campaigning helps shape the future political culture of the electorate that is going to define what is possible tomorrow. And Democrats are always sacrificing that to win today. So they sacrifice what is possible tomorrow. And you'll see, especially immigration, which is, you know, one of the big issues of this election.
They're eating the cats.
And where have Democrats been on it? You know, they just keep wanting to prove to Republicans that they're just as Republican as Republicans, but, you know, just compassionate. Democrats have become the compassionate conservatives.
Ours is a compassionate genocide.
And you lose the public on it. You know, right now, there was a poll earlier this year, 51% of Americans said they supported mass deportation of undocumented immigrants. Where have Democrats been on this issue?
Vice President Harris, you were tasked by President Biden with getting to the root causes of migration from
Central
America.
They haven't been tying it in with climate change, especially with our foreign policy. At this point, it was 42% of Democrats supported mass deportation. Just crazy. What's going on in the Democratic Party? Like, you know, they don't believe in anything, it seems like. But the problem is, no one's willing to risk a few elections to try to change public opinion on this. No one's willing to step outside of the boundaries of what is accepted as your current political reality, what's claimed to be, you know, the beliefs of that mythical Midwest independent swing state voter that the media and both parties, especially Democrats, though, let's be real, mostly Democrats, you know, just pander to when it comes to election season. And the problem is, if you care about nothing except winning, at the end of the day, you care about nothing except gaining power. And that's been the problem with the Democratic Party. They care about gaining power for nothing.
And then they'll call you.
They don't do anything
with
it. They don't inform, and they don't shape culture with their campaigns in a way that lets them do the kind of progressive policy that they pretend that they want when it's time to inspire people to get out the vote. Then they wonder why they lose in the midterms 2 years later. They wonder why Trump gets elected. You know, this is why, because of your failure. You know, fascism grows where liberalism fails, where, you know, where leftism, you know, is not taking root, where there's no collective pro-social impulses in the culture. And how does that happen? It's because big money fueling media, everything becomes propaganda.
Everything becomes propaganda.
And so I would say something like, you know, 90 something, 98, 99% of Democrats really stand for nothing. And then you wonder why Trump gets elected. Like, this should not be a competitive election right here between this freaking insane Nazi clown car, the Republicans, and Donald Trump. And how is this even close? This is just a testament to the long-term strategic failure of the strategy of the Democratic Party. And yet they will never admit it. So what do you do as a voter?
Vote or die, motherfucker, motherfucker, vote or die.
Elector, noun. One who enjoys the sacred privilege of voting for the man of another man's choice. The Devil's Dictionary. Ambrose Bierce.
Rock the vote.
Campaigns are the opportunity to reach out to the public, to change their mind, to shape the public discourse, to inject new ideas into the public discourse, you know, to challenge the popular right-wing narratives. And yet, if you're not going to go out on a limb on your campaign because you want to win, then you're going to forfeit that capacity to shape the future electorate. And you can say that you can do some pussyfooting bills that people aren't going to care about, or are going to marginally make things better, or that are going to be real compromised, and like Obamacare, Democrats had a supermajority, right, and passed a Republican health care bill. And then what happened? And then the Tea Party happened. And then that led directly to Trump. And that's all Democrats have accomplished in my lifetime. As far as major policy, is a Republican health care bill. In my entire lifetime, that's all they've accomplished. So what do you expect? How do you expect to inspire voters? Just by being the lesser evil?
Children, this is how we fill them. The four, they're going to kill us all. I'm inside a beehive. This is where my soul hides. Deep
Story about 2010s. Still a little bit of hope left alive in this world. See, the new Gilded Age started off right in the Occupy movement, Occupy Wall Street. That wasn't even first. First, the climate movement wasn't even a thing until this started. You had 1,000 arrests on the White House fence, protesting the Keystone XL pipeline. Yes, sir. Shortly after began the Occupy Wall Street movement. And after that, well, it was off to the races for movements in general for a couple years. We had the Keystone XL, the beginning of the Black Lives Matter movement. We had Fight for 15, More Mondays. Oh, the list goes on and on. Movements for years. Social media, let people organize, get together, fight for a better future. But you know, that led to a lot of it came up to the culmination there in the Bernie Sanders campaign 2016. I tell you. Good run a couple years after that. Climate movement really got going. Bernie Sanders lost. The climate movement reached its peak shortly thereafter. Extinction Rebellion, Greta Thunberg was getting all kinds of media coverage. Especially once Trump came in, it was, you know, all of a sudden, every Democrat from left to far right. Every single Democrat gave a shit about the future of the species on this planet, climate change all of a sudden, just like magic. People were out in the streets, we shut down downtown, we interrupted the State Energy Regulatory Committee, gave them a good little, raised their heart rate a little, let's say that. And, you know, it all started in the UK, they had things going over there. Called the UK is used to be Britain. It used to be a country back in the day. It was a part of Europe. If you remember, you don't know what that is. But yeah, they had it going over there, and then all of a sudden, 2020 came. The United States had another presidential election. We had a lot of protests that year. The George Floyd Rebellion, Extinction Rebellion, going right into that. People were rising up all over. Against the injustices that had persisted for too long. Looking out for the future of this, you know, for the country that this used to be. Good old United States. Well, anyway, Joe Biden got elected. Everyone thought this shit was over. But Trump was gone, fascism was defeated. We gotta protest no more. Got Joe Biden in there. Joe Biden in the White House. No need to protest, no need to, everybody simmer down. And then, you know, there's a stop cop city movement, and they're to get it, you know. Just teach us the new way of things. And then the Britain, they started sentencing their climate protesters to jail for years just for shutting down a shitty-ass road. Don't even have a real name, M25. What the fuck kind of name is that for a road? Why'd you name it after a president? Why don't you name it after a Prime Minister, whatever the fuck, a queen or some shit, whatever the hell they had in the Greatest Britain. But no, the M25 should charge whoever named that shit. What the hell? So anyway, Biden was elected. It looked like fascism was defeated once and for good. But that's because people are stupid. What happened was they just stopped giving a shit for a couple years. That's what happened every time the Democrats come in. And you know, a lot of people want to blame that, oh, people got pessimistic, oh, it was the pandemic. Yeah, the pandemic's part of it. You know, people just stopped protesting afterwards. Everyone just gave up. Everyone gave up all at once. And there's been many protests since. You've been charged with terrorism, thrown in jail for years. Some ended up like Tortuguita, shot. God knows too damn many times. And then, you know, everything just kind of fell apart from there. There's a lesson in there. Democrats take power and just stop giving a shit. It's back to brunch, baby. It's your back to brunch special. Cooking the world. That nobody gave a damn.
The children, this is how we fill them. The four, they're going to kill us all. Inside a beehive, this is where my soul has declined.
Twisted tendency in politics, especially American politics, to use children as flags, really, to use a fake concern over children and their well-being to smuggle in bullshit policies or to sell bullshit.
Something else I'm getting tired of is all this stupid bullshit we have to listen to all the time about children. It's all you hear in this country. Children, help the children. What about the children? Save the children.
We just wanted one question for the children. The kids.
From CoCor.
On the Democratic side, they love talking about the youth vote now. When they talk about climate, a lot of times they always bring up, oh, the youth are concerned about it. Naturally.
Republicans under the age of 45 favor the U.S. taking steps to try and reduce climate change.
The twisted part there is they don't give a shit. I mean, look at what Democrats do on climate. They clearly aren't looking out for the next generation. They're just using them. It's just the red flag they're waving in front of the bull trying to get them into the voting booth on election day. And then after that, we'll pass some bill that industry is going to write for us and is going to make them very happy. And, you know, maybe under historic pressure, if we can get a shit bill like the Inflation Reduction Act. Then you'll have on the Republican side, which is worse overall because they're also completely fucked on climate and just deny it. But then they love to bring up, oh, the concern for the babies, Democrats are baby killers. You know, while they're dooming the future that these babies would grow into and don't give a shit as soon as they're born, as soon as they pop out. They don't care if they're malnourished going in, if their health care is inadequate. The United States has the highest infant and maternal mortality rate of any high-income country in the world, even though we spend more money than any other country. And it's largely because of Republicans and policies that they, you know, fight for and push for. And then they'll also use children when it comes to the whole bigoted anti-gay and anti-trans agenda, which a lot of times they couch in protecting children. You know, they're doing it in the schools. The teachers are teaching them butt sex. They went to a drag show.
The left-wing gender insanity being pushed on our children is an act of child abuse. Very simple. Here's my plan to stop the chemical, physical, and emotional mutilation of our youth.
They always couch their bigotry in terms of protecting the children, and yet look at everything. Look how they've degraded education. Look how they've doomed the future. I mean, we're on track. These same kids are on track to experience a world in their older age that might be 4 degrees Celsius. They live into their 80s. You know, it's going to be 3-4 degrees Celsius hotter than pre-industrial times on this planet. And that's not going to be pleasant. And then on top of it now, both parties are supporting a genocide of predominantly children, 50% children, because they're children, to stop them from growing up. So it's this whole save the children, we care about the children, protect the children, worry about the youth vote shit is fucking disgusting.
No serious country should be telling its children that they were born with the wrong gender.
Of course, as we all know, the ironic thing about, you know, bigots, right-wingers, Republicans, and their whole anti-gay, anti-trans agenda, it's like every accusation is a confession.
Everyone I disagree with
and
is a
so
pedophile.
And there's so much repression going on. You know, we see, I mean, J.D. Vance, isn't J.D. Vance dressed in drag once? And then you have people like Trump, who evangelicals elect. Very good friends with freaking Epstein. Shocker there. Shocker there. Wonder what they were doing. But of course, the Clintons were also friends with Epstein, but Trump is probably closer. Who knows? Bunch of freaks.
Welcome.
These people don't care about the kids. Not one of them. Neither party, neither candidate. No one really thinks and gives a shit. Even people who have kids. I'm wondering, like, what are you thinking? People just don't know. People are just ignorant because they don't care. You know, everyone knows about it. No one's totally in the dark about the concept of global warming, climate change, and, you know, all the what it's going to bring. And we see it. We see it. And yet still, no one really seems to give a shit. Even when we had large protests, you know, the Extinction Rebellion and different things, and the People's Climate March is maybe probably one of the biggest ones, 400,000 people, which is a lot of people for the U.S., to be fair. But, I mean, out of 300 million people, though, like, looking out for the future of the species, I mean, it's, you know, this whole presidential race is very much a reflection of that. And just how we don't give a shit about the next generation. This is all like an intergenerational Ponzi scheme we're running here. We're the main beneficiaries.
Hey, knock it off! There's a kid back there!
I'm in danger!
Everybody complains about politicians. Everybody says they suck.
Yeah!
Well, where do people think these politicians come from? They don't fall out of the sky. They don't pass through a membrane from another reality. They come from American parents and American families, American homes, American schools, American churches, American businesses, and American universities, and they're elected by American citizens. This is the best we can do, folks. This is what we have to offer. It's what our system produces. Garbage in, garbage out.
President Harris, you call climate change an existential threat. The question to you both tonight is, what would you do to fight climate change? And Vice President Harris, we'll start with you. 1 minute for you each. 1 minute for you each. 1 minute for you each. 1 minute.
This is the craziest part of this whole election to me, almost. One debate between the two major candidates for the president of the leader of the free world, president of the United States. One question about the biggest, most existential problem that mankind has ever faced. Very complex. Everything that we know is at stake. And they get 1 minute each. 1 minute. Out of what? Like, it was like a 2 or 3 hour debate. 1 minute. 1 minute to talk about humanity. How humanity can avoid self-imposed extinction from climate collapse. A decision that we will finalize our decision on as a species during this administration. I mean, 1 minute, fuck, I want to hear them talk for 30 minutes, an hour. Give them each an hour. Give every presidential candidate an hour to talk about climate. And And then you can act like you're running for president. How about something like that? I really want to hear fucking even Kamala Harris talk for an hour about climate. Much less Trump. What a fuck show that would be. Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. It'd be 30 minutes on his fucking expertise on windmills, how they're killing all the birds.
When the wind stops blowing, that's the end of your electric. Let's hurry up. Darling, is the wind blowing today?
I mean, we got Joe Biden out here delivering pizzas. We got Donald Trump cooking fries at McDonald's. And you know, for an interview for these jobs would be more difficult than an interview for the presidency at the most crucial point in humanity. Like, what are we doing? You'd have a more difficult interview at freaking McDonald's,
never
at freaking
Trump.
Domino's. Oh my God, and yet if the entire world is at stake and you're applying for that fucking job that decides the fate of fucking humanity, the most crucial point in human history, the last chance we really have to do anything. One minute each.
1 minute for you each.
We're so fucked.
You already know what time it is.
It's party time, motherfucker. It's party time, motherfucker.
And I am proud that as vice president over the last 4 years, we have invested $1 trillion in a clean energy economy.
I never understood wind, and I know windmills very much.
We have created over 800,000 new manufacturing jobs.
You want to see a bird cemetery? Go under a windmill sometime.
Climate change has become a climate crisis. And a threat has now become a reality.
We put a little statue for birds.
While we have also increased domestic gas production to historic levels.
Well, I guess let's hear what the vice presidential candidates have to say about the survival of humanity.
And Ori, you asked about climate change. I think this is a very important issue. Look, a lot of people are justifiably worried about all these crazy weather patterns. I think it's important for us, first of all, to say Donald Trump and I support clean air, clean water.
Senator Vance has said that there's a climate problem in the past. Donald Trump called it a hoax and then joked that these things would make more beachfront property to be able to invest in.
If we actually care about getting cleaner air and cleaner water, the best thing to do is to double down and invest in American workers and the American people.
The Harris administration now, the Biden-Harris administration, is we've seen this investment. We've seen massive investments, the biggest in global history that we've seen in the Inflation Reduction Act.
You'd want to reshore as much American manufacturing as possible.
Taking the EV technology that we invented and making it here. 200,000 jobs across the country.
What they would be doing is more manufacturing and more energy production in the United States of America.
The largest solar manufacturing plant in North America sits in Minnesota.
And you'd want to produce as much energy as possible in the United States of America.
We are producing more natural gas and more oil at any time than we ever have. We are seeing us becoming an energy superpower for the future. And then we start thinking about how do we mitigate these disasters. So the solution for us is to continue to move forward. Now look, coming back to the climate change issue.
And this is just fucking crazy. The climate change issue. And then we move on to mitigation. And then we move on to mitigation. No, and then your lack of mitigation moves on to your whole civilization. Moves on it like
and
a
moved
bitch.
Her like a bitch.
What
and
are these? Star, this is why you can't it. Even take Democrats seriously. This is what's frustrating. Like, if you have a grasp of climate change and climate politics, ecology, environmentalism, whatever you want to fucking call the whole big picture, the biosphere, the sphere of life. Clearly, if you have any grasp of that, none of these people are even like in the realm of keeping this place habitable. Insane. Ultimately, none of these politicians are going to stand up against the oil and gas industry and the cash money, economic growth to save the planet, just to save life on the planet. Wouldn't you rather make money? You really want to keep the planet habitable? What have you ever considered? Fat stacks of Benjamins, bitch! It's crazy. What are these fucking people doing? Republicans are just off the farm on the shit. So it's easy. It's easy to just mock Republicans on climate change. Clean air and clean water. But they're not serious about either of those even. Like, they're totally not serious. You could think Trump gave a shit about clean air, clean water. I mean, I don't know any of the data or the metrics. But I guarantee you, I mean, I would have no doubt in my mind that Trump, his administration, his policies, and Republicans in Congress have been a net negative on the quality of water and air in this country. No question.
Donald Trump and I support clean air, clean water. That's just pure bullshit clown talk.
And shut up, JD. The fuck kind of name is JD? Anyway, that's why kind of the bigger problem is the Democrats. If there's no party that's saying, we got two party choices and one's never going to be saying on climate, then what about the other? Well, let's take a look. I mean, we got Tim Walz coming from Minnesota. It's Minnesota, right? Governor of Minnesota? Pretty sure. One of those states. I don't know. You know, when you don't live there and you drive through them, they all look the same. Minnesota, Missouri, Ohio, where I'm from, I get it. People tell me that I drove through Ohio. There was nothing. Yeah, I know. It wasn't even a question that Tim Walz was going to be an absolute buffoon when it came to climate. I mean, he's from a very agricultural state. What's he going to have to say? They gave him 2 minutes in the vice presidential race. Only 1 minute for the presidential race, because that makes sense. But yeah, so they had 2 minutes to ramble mostly about how they feel so much. You know, it was right on the heels of Hurricane Helene. So they were, of course, they felt so much for the victims. Both candidates felt so, you know, such heartfelt sympathy and empathy and support for the victims. The federal government was going to have their backs for the victims of this hurricane. And they completely agreed on basically everything they said, which tells you everything. That says more than anything they could have said. It was like the level of their agreement here. They act like they don't live on this planet. I don't get it. These people have just lost their minds. They literally are just, there's some combination of not giving a fuck and not knowing a shit where these people land. Like, this is one of the complex problems where if you don't know about it, it's easy to not care. But if you know about it, you can't not care. I mean, if you know about climate change, it doesn't, you know, on some level, it doesn't matter what your politics in quotation marks are, left or right, all that shit. It kind of doesn't matter. You're negotiating with the laws of physics, which are not wincing for you, little ape. The laws of physics are not, they don't care. Whatever your excuse, whatever your opinion, whatever, it doesn't matter. It doesn't fucking matter. Gravity, does it care if you jump off a bridge? Like, well, my politics, though. I believed in gravity. Doesn't matter. You're going to hit the ground and go splat.
We're not going to make it, are we? People, I mean.
It's in your nature to destroy yourselves.
Yeah. Age of drag, huh?
On some level, if you think all politics comes down to all major level party politics, especially in places like the United States, come down to humanity grappling with climate collapse in this age that we're in, then it's easy to see how you could think that it's possible that Walz was chosen as kind of an olive branch to the agricultural industry, which is one of the biggest, it's the biggest, hardest, most fundamental, difficult area of carbon emissions to deal with and our climate impact. Not just carbon emissions, but destruction of carbon sinks and everything else. Agriculture was always going to be it was obvious because you need to eat. At the end of the day, you need to eat. That's kind of what the whole problem comes down to. But then it comes down to what we eat and democracy and these other issues. And, you know, obviously plant-based versus animal agriculture is the big issue, but we can't talk about that. And why is one of the reasons? Well, because we have politicians like Tim Walz coming around who's, you know, got pictures of him spanking a newborn pig or whatever kind of weird shit. And they act like that's fucking normal because he's in camouflage. You know, he might just be Democrats saying to the agriculture industry that, look, we're not going to come after you. We might talk big about climate and everything, but don't worry. We're just going to keep bailing you out. But at the end of the day, that's what Tim Walz has always done. Tim Walz, I mean, he's had to, but what does that mean? He could also have been a leader and lost an election. But instead, he chose to, you know, shill for factory farming and biofuels. And biofuels are insane. The fact that we're so much of the United States is devoted to fucking biofuels. 17 million acres of the United States are dedicated to biofuels. And if you've ever been in any of these seas of corn, I mean, you see it. All that's grown for animal agriculture and biofuels, which are probably not a net benefit over gasoline. And we've got so many cars going hybrid and electric at this point. Like, this is, why are we leaning into this? And yet Tim Walz is leaning into this. He's huddled up with his Republican buddies and gone up against Trump and the Trump administration and the oil industry. And why did he go up against the oil industry? To fight an exemption for small refineries for a biofuel quota, basically. So he, you know, him and some Republicans were to the right of the Trump administration on the oil companies on this. But this is the type of shit, if you don't know and you don't care, this is easy for you to ignore. And yet when you know about it, it's just, it's fucking insane. You know, during the debate, his whole, I love to shoot and kill poor innocent little creatures too. I'm a real man, just like J.D. Vance, just like Republicans. I like to hunt. I have to get my rifle and go find some skinny little herbivore running through the woods, just trying to survive, and I shoot it in the back of the head and say, fuck you. I'm a real man. I'm a Democrat and a real man too. Like, it's crazy. The way that Democrats fold to this right-wing macho man bullshit, it's fucking pathetic. This is not compatible with living in a biosphere. As a species that's overrun the planet with 8 billion apes, like, you're just not being serious. You are nowhere fit to be near the role of commanding any political direction of this enterprise, a civilization, at a point in history like this. And yet here you are, just because you'll be another industry's whore, just like the Republicans. Yeah. And you all fucking agree on everything anyway. So what's the fucking point, dude? It's fuck China. We'll make the solar panels here. We'll bail out the farmers. We're gonna go hunting together. Dude, what the fuck? Where are the two parties? I thought this was a two-party system, dude. All I see is one. You know, Democrats like to say this election is an existential crisis, turning point and everything. And yeah, it probably is. But I think, you know, it might be the pivot point where we see that we've already made the choice of what we're going to do. I mean, we're choosing genocide, climate collapse, corporate, full doom loop. Full doom loop. Welcome to the motherfucking doom loop. We've already made the choice to go extinct and kill everything on Earth for money. Just for money. For some cash little bills, we're going to print some slave owners' faces on and act like this is all that matters on the planet. We are insane. We're so insane. What are we fucking doing?
If you have selfish, ignorant citizens, you're going to get selfish, ignorant leaders. And term limits ain't going to be any good. You're just going to wind up with a brand new bunch of selfish, ignorant Americans. So maybe it's not the politicians who suck. Maybe something else sucks around here, like the public. Yeah, the public sucks. There's a nice campaign slogan for somebody. The public sucks. Fuck hope. Fuck hope.
Burn. We'll all burn. Burn. City's great people weeping in the parking lot, treading another day at work. Melancholia for someone that never was. Honey, did we consume enough for Christmas? What you are missing in life in pursuit of the unattainable, out of the natural world. Status quo, a madness, our dirty lands on the world. What's really happening? The land of the free, the future once seemed so bright. What happened? Has Western society lost its soul? Not of the natural world, the status quo, a madness. Our dirty lands on the world. Broken, angry man, nothing to say. The age of collective delusion, the end of stage of grief, the insanity of humanity. It's not you, it's them. Broken, daddy, what you leave behind for me? What do you call the feeling of a dying planet? The missing stage of grief. Not
world broken. Broken, angry man, nothing to say. Age of collective delusion, the end of exponential growth. Broken, out of the natural world, the status quo of madness. On the world broken, the insanity of humanity. It's not you, it's them. Broken, now would you leave behind for me? What do you call the feeling of a dying planet, the missing stage of grief? Out of the natural world, the status quo of madness. Our dirty legs on the world.
Was Broken by Dennis Lustinetz, the Devil's Therapist. On November 1st, 2024, climate activist Greta Thunberg posted the following message on the website formerly known as Twitter.
On November 5th, it is time for one of the most powerful countries in the world, the USA, to go to the polls. It is probably impossible to overestimate the consequences this specific election will have for the world and the future of humanity. There is no doubt that one of the candidates, Trump, is way more dangerous than the other. But no matter if Trump or Harris wins, the USA, a country built on stolen land and genocide on indigenous people, will still be an imperialist, hyper-capitalist world power that will ultimately continue to lead the world further into a racist, unequal world with an ever-increasingly escalating climate and environmental emergency. With this in mind, my main message to Americans is to remember that you cannot only settle for the least worst option. Democracy is not only every 4 years on election day, but also every hour of every day in between. You cannot think you have done enough only by voting, especially when both those candidates have blood on their hands. Let's not forget that the genocide in Palestine is happening under the Biden and Harris administration with American money and complicity. It is not in any way feminist, progressive, or humanitarian to bomb innocent children and civilians. It is the opposite, even if it is a woman in charge. And this is, of course, one example among many of American imperialism. I cannot for my life understand how some can even pretend to talk about humanitarian values without even questioning their own role in further deepening global oppression and massacres of entire countries. So, Americans, you must do everything in your power to call out this extreme hypocrisy and the catastrophic consequences American imperialism has on a global scale. Be uncomfortable, fill the streets, block, organize, boycott, occupy. Explicitly call out those in power whose actions and inaction lead to death and destruction. Join and support those who are resisting and leading the change. Nothing less will ever be acceptable.
She beat me out on Time Magazine. She beat me out on Time Magazine. She beat me out on Time Magazine.
America, I think it's time we talked about lesser evil voting. For real this time. Holy shit.
Now, I guess if we're going to talk about climate, if we're going to talk about the presidential election through the lens of climate, it's easy to say that one seems like a greater evil and one seems like the lesser evil. But really, it's not even that simple, unfortunately. That's how bad shit is. For starters, I mean, we heard they're basically on the same policy. Like, you know, if we have, under a Democratic administration, we're going to have some more solar panels, more funding for solar panels.
wind turbines and battery, which is something, you know, that's way over everyone's head. That no one thinks about battery, but it's the most important, crucial part of keeping our electricity system running. And but so, of course, no one mentioned battery. Not a presidential, not a vice presidential candidate mentioned battery because they don't give a shit about climate at the end of the day. They don't give a shit about if your electricity stays on because they know they and their rich friends are going to be able to afford electricity no matter how expensive it gets. The grid goes down, they'll have their own microgrids for the plutocrats or bunkers or islands, whatever. But the masses, no, they think, you know, fuck you, and they don't care, and they think they'll be safe from you.
Tell me, do you know what day it is, Evie?
November the 4th.
Not anymore.
So Kamala may be a lesser evil in like a one-to-one comparison. Well, of course. I mean, well, you know, well, I don't know. It gets more complicated each day. Like, let's be real. Kamala's into a genocide, and Trump never really committed an open genocide like this. And whereas at this point, Harris is, you know, she's been in the administration the whole time as the second in command. Let's be, I don't know. Is Joe Biden even alive? He might be technically brain dead half the day. Who knows? He's been on mental vacation for at least 6 months. And so she's basically at the top, you know, nominal person in charge, at least. I don't know who else is there behind this. I don't know how shit is running at all in this country. Obviously, we don't need the White House very much. Holy shit. I don't know how anything's running, but we're supposed to be an executive manager. It's supposed to just come, it's supposed to be one person. And where's Joe Biden? Like, he's been was fucked up when he had his mind. I don't even know when maybe he's less fucked up now. Maybe we should be grateful that Joe Biden is going fucking senile. So at this point, like, yeah, you know, seems like Democrats are the lesser evil in a one-to-one comparison. And they probably are in a one-to-one comparison, to be fair. Yeah. And yet here we are, where Democrats have very obviously a more evil, more fucked up, more pro-war, more pro-imperialist foreign policy than even Trump does. Even though Trump has a more authoritarian. Trump is definitely more pro-authoritarian, don't get me wrong. But he doesn't seem to like violence. I think because he's a soft rich kid. And in this case, that's not a bad thing. Like, you know, he only likes violence against people who insult him personally or oppose him or maybe could put him in jail. You know, he wants violence against them and his political opponents. But, you know, he doesn't like violence in general as much as, you know, Democrats can just really get over it. And it's been fucking amazing to see with this genocide. But Democrats have always been monsters. I mean, LBJ. The Vietnam War was largely a Democratic Party genocide, too. So genocide is nothing new to the American Democratic Party. Let's be clear. At the end of the day, you know, the big issue here is we have a problem, especially in America, and maybe because of social media, with systems thinking versus more soap opera type thinking. I don't know what to call it. More focused on personality and individuals. Instead of thinking strategically about presidential elections, we think about them like a high school popularity contest, some kind of reality TV show, which is perfect with having Trump. I mean, that's why Trump is such a perfect presidential candidate for America. People want to say, oh, he's such an aberration. No, he's not. He's the most American thing since Apple Pie, bro. What do you mean? When people say that, they just use clearly you have not. You are either being completely dishonest or you're completely ignorant. I don't know. Anyway. You know, we need to be able to think about systems and not just people, not just individuals, not just looking at everything like it's some, you know, the latest soap opera, the latest drama on Netflix, the latest reality TV show, the new Bachelor season. No, we need to look at systems and how we work in them because people will adapt to the systems, but the systems are rigid. And unless we change the systems, which is hard to do, then the people will adapt to the systems. And so clearly we have broken systems and we can see that. You know, most people accept that with their political system, but they want to accept that in their framing, in the framing that works for what they already believe. It's part of the problem, which is, you know, another system. You know, we need to be able to think about these systems. We need to think about our climate system. We need to be able to think about our political system. We need to think about our cultural, social systems, our ecosystem. We need to take a holistic view. Lesser evil voting results in greater evil. And it's very clear why when you look at it as a system. It's the whole ratchet effect. Since the system is corrupted by money, money will always have the advantage. And so if you keep going along with that drift, if Democrats want to keep playing the lesser evil and keep cutting, you know, splitting the difference with Republicans for decades, what's going to happen? Well, that's going to allow and encourage Republicans to keep moving to the right, as they've done, you know, very predictably. And then, so what do Democrats do to try to keep splitting the difference in every election? They keep moving to the right. And so what happens? The whole system keeps moving to the right. And so all the political messaging in the country keeps moving to the right. And so the whole political system keeps moving to the right over decades. And it's this slow drift. And at some point, you need to stop it. You can't just keep voting lesser evil. This is what lesser evil voting gets you.
Delegation. Noun. In American politics, an article of merchandise that comes in sets. The Devil's Dictionary.
If Democrats aren't going to hold their ground, then the voters are going to have to make them. And sometimes that will mean during general elections because of the fucking chicanery that goes on inside Democratic Party primaries, quote unquote Democratic Party primaries. We need to stop voting for evil at some point. At some points, it makes sense. Maybe as a strategic option. Maybe in 2020, it made sense to vote for lesser evil. But like, we have to make some kind of calculation, and people have to get organized enough where we can do this on a more collective level rather than just like, oh, well, I'm going to vote for Jill Stein because I don't support genocide. Other people will overlook genocide because of abortion rights. And those are both. But it's fucked up. We're in a fucked up place. There's no good choice. If Democrats are never going to hold any ground on the left, if they're never going to stake out any ground and stand for anything, which we haven't seen any sign of, then we're never going to hold the center. The center is not going to hold. We're going to swing to the right so far that our whole civilization breaks into 1,000 pieces. And you shouldn't be surprised at that. You shouldn't blame that all on Trump. That's not Trump. Trump is a symptom. Trump is not the disease. Trump is a symptom. But Democrats want to act like he's the disease. He's the root problem here. No, he's just a symptom of the system that you've been perpetuating for decades. And so what's their solution? Keep doing the same thing. You know, ultimately, the system moving to the right means we're moving towards fascism, ecological collapse, bad things for every living sentient being on this planet, except for maybe the small segment of the super rich who are going to be able to avoid some of these consequences for a short time with some petty luxuries. And ultimately, are they even going to be happy? Look at these clowns like Elon Musk. This motherfucker is such an insecure little freak. But he's the richest person in the world. And he's still such a little insecure high school freakish man boy, like, you know, and you know, this is not the way to fulfillment as a species. We are lost. Look at where we are. We are finally breaching 1.5 degrees Celsius of global warming above pre-industrial levels. And here we are in one of the most influential country on the planet. And the lesser evil party presidential candidate is vowing to support continued fracking and genocide from a world that has to come together to deal with our whole ecological situation, supporting a genocide that's going to destabilize
the world. As Commander-in-Chief, I will ensure America always has the strongest, most lethal fighting force in the world.
And fracking, which means, let's be clear, this means exporting liquid natural gas, which has a greater carbon footprint than coal. But the thing is, we put it on another country's ledger. So then we can say, oh, we know we're moving towards green energy and our carbon emissions are down. But really, we're exporting and importing so much that are just not accounted for anywhere. The destruction of the Amazon for our Burger King burgers, not accounted for. Tim Walz is happy about that. Kamala Harris, Joe Biden, Barack Obama, everybody's happy that liquid natural gas, all our exports there, all those carbon emissions are not being traced back to us, accounted for by us, and all the methane leakage along the way and along all the gas infrastructure we have in this country that these same people keep voting for, and then, oh, slap a green leaf on it. It burns 50% cleaner than CO2. Yeah, but it also leaks. And we've known this for a decade. This is not new. This is a decade plus, longer than a decade, 15 fucking years now. I mean, when they were doing this shit, I remember like that. It was kind of like the learning curve where science was learning, people were learning, and activists were spreading the word on it. But this happened under the Obama administration. People knew that methane was going to be leaking with this new infrastructure, which everything you do, whether you're digging for oil, fracking, sending gas here, left, right, east, west, it leaks. And methane is a very potent greenhouse gas, and it acts on a shorter time frame. And that's not even... I don't think there's any way that's properly accounted for at this point in climate models. And, you know, now you'll hear, like, that it's surprising that methane is skyrocketing. And a lot of
Vice
it now
President,
recently, I guess,
not
because
ban
of natural
fracking.
Reasons,
as president, I will not ban
a lot
fracking.
Of the short-term warming is because we just started fracking instead of coal, which has a longer but slower and more sustained warming impact.
Not to mention aerosol.
Methane over a 20-year time span has over 80 times the warming potential of CO2. But it breaks down close to a decade, whereas CO2 can last for hundreds of years. So,
natural gas is drastic and immediate.
Methane leakage, drastic and immediate. So, and it's happening everywhere. And it's toxic. When it happens in your home, you know, you don't want to fucking breathe that. You don't want your kids to breathe that unless you're a psycho like most people.
Good, honest, hardworking people, white collar, blue collar, doesn't matter what color shirt you have on. Good, honest, hardworking people continue. These are people of modest means. Continue to elect these rich cocksuckers who don't give a fuck about them. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't care about you at all. At all. At all. Yeah. You know? And nobody seems to notice, nobody seems to care. That's what the owners count on, the fact that Americans will probably remain willfully ignorant of the big red, white, and blue dick that's being jammed up their assholes every day. Because the owners of this country know the truth. It's called the American dream, because you have to be asleep to believe it.
We've got this weird kind of political denialism. It's part of like the whole post-truth America thing that media outlets and educated liberals love to go on about, you know, we're post-truth, no one cares about the facts anymore. Like, yeah, but this is not a partisan issue. Just because Trump is insane and off the wheels doesn't mean your party is, you know, in line with scientific reality at all. As you know, if you follow climate at all, Democrats are off the farm too. There are a lot of people who know better, who claim that politicians are going to do things that they know they're not going to do and stop things that they're actively causing.
We've come to the point where every 4 years this national fever rises up. This hunger for the savior, the white knight, the man on horseback. And whoever wins becomes so immensely powerful, like Nixon is now, that when you vote for president today, you're talking about giving a man dictatorial power for 4 years. I think it might be better to have the president sort of like the King of England or the Queen, and have the real business of the presidency conducted by a city manager type, prime minister, somebody who's directly answerable to Congress rather than a person who moves all his friends into the White House and does whatever he wants for 4 years. The whole framework of the presidency is getting out of hand. It's come to the point where you almost can't run unless you can cause people to salivate and whip on each other with big sticks. You almost have to be a rock star to get the kind of fever you need to survive in American politics.
Hunter S. Thompson, Fear and Loathing on the Campaign Trail.
Climate is the great lens to look at politics through because it really just breaks everything down because you can't argue with the laws of physics. And so you know they're ultimately going to win and you can see who's full of shit, who knows what they're talking about, who cares enough to know. And if they don't, then they're not fit for the fucking job. Like, people will use climate change as a reason to vote for Democrats, but they know that Harris supports fracking and nothing's really going to change. The planet's going to keep warming. We're going to have record carbon emissions next year. Nothing's going to get better on that issue, and yet they'll make the claim. You know, truly not care. And they'll talk about, you know, reproductive rights is a big thing, but the Congress isn't going to be able to do anything about that, especially not with the filibuster, which Democrats also didn't even fight to get rid of under Biden. Democrats don't fight like they believe the things they say when they say we're in an existential crisis. And yet they say, oh, well, that's going too far. Well, it's an existential crisis. Like, there should be nothing too far by definition. And yet, everything is too far. Moderate Democrat who's going to be portrayed as a communist by the Republican Party no matter what. And then they're going to answer to that. Democrats are going to run in fear from their claims of being a communist. Run to the right. But like people will say that Kamala Harris might stop the genocide. We know she's not going to stop the genocide. I mean, Trump most likely won't either. But we know Harris won't. At this point, like, she could have already stopped the genocide in Gaza. Why wouldn't she do it then? The party in charge is promising, we're going to lower grocery prices. You're the party in charge. Your administration is in the White House. What do you mean you're going to lower grocery prices? What do you mean you're going to do something about housing? You're already in charge. I mean, maybe people don't see through it. I don't know. I don't want to overestimate the average American voter at this point, but it's open denial. I don't know if it's, I don't know. On some level, I don't like saying people are too stupid to know that they're in denial, but maybe. Maybe that's a lot of our problems. We're too stupid to know we're in denial, and we're too in denial to ever learn that we're stupid. I'm gonna stay here, do what I'm gonna do. Now I'm giving a damn. One part of this political nihilism going on now is this whole refusal on the part of, even Democrats who you might used to have viewed as progressive and thoughtful, this denial that things have gotten worse in the past 4 years. And, every party does this on some level, but, we are now. And in the last 4 years, Democrats have been doing it. And I mean, you see it with inflation, the housing crisis. Democrats, liberals, Biden gave up on climate change and COVID
And now they're used both as wedge issues. And they did in the 2020 too. And yet, what did they do since then? You know, oh, well, pandemic's over. Oh, well, you know, we're going to pass the IRA, which they blitzed us on that. They blitzed us. Them the Ivy League motherfuckers blitzed us. That was not a climate bill, and no one should have ever accepted that shit. The climate movement went crazy over it at first, and I was even duped by it. I thought, like, okay, wow, maybe this is a good thing on climate. And then the more you look into it, looking at things like expecting by 2030, the U.S. is going to be sucking out 200 million tons of carbon through carbon capture. You could see from, you know, 8.5 years away that was total bullshit. And now we're halfway there, and it's total clown talk. And so we're at like 2023, 2024, we're around 22 million metric tons of CO2 captured per year. And yeah, so that's like roughly a tenth of where we're supposed to be in now, you know, 5.5 years. And who knows what's going to happen politically in the meantime. And that really was a pressure release valve for momentum for demand, for public demand for climate action. And so I don't even know if we should expect more climate legislation by 2030. Nothing serious, of course. I mean, the IRA was a joke, and it was the biggest climate action we've ever seen. Which is fair to say, it's a nice sluttiest nun contest. It was the greatest climate bill ever. It's the most whore nun. Okay, gonna see some shin. But like, look, we're trying to save the planet. This is just crazy. There's no negotiation here. People act like our contest with China means something in the face of fucking annihilation by the laws of physics. Like, what are you boomers thinking? They're stuck in some 90s frame of mind or something. Our whole political system. We're stuck. We're fucked.
We are trying to ask you to vote yes on the Green New Deal.
Okay, I'll tell you what. We have our own Green New Deal.
Some scientists have said that we have 12 years to turn this around.
Well, it's not going to get turned around in 10 years. What we can do,
Senator, if this doesn't get turned around in 10 years, you're looking at the faces of the people who are going to be living with these consequences.
The government is supposed to be for the people and by the people and all for the people.
You know what's interesting about this group is I've been doing this for 30 years. I know what I'm doing. You come in here and you say it has to be my way or the highway. I don't respond to that. I've gotten elected. I just ran. I was elected by almost 1 million vote plurality. And I know what I'm doing. So, you know, maybe people should listen a little bit.
I hear what you're saying, but we're the people who voted you. You're supposed to listen to us. That's your job.
How old are you?
I'm 16. I can't vote.
Well, you didn't vote for me.
Well, she voted.
It doesn't matter. We're the ones who are going to be impacted. It doesn't matter. We're going to be the ones who are impacted.
I understand that. I have 7 grandchildren. I understand it very well.
Senator, the cost of not taking this action is far higher than the cost of what the Green New Deal will be. And there is enormous popularity for this bill around the whole country. And we're asking you to be brave and do this for us and for your grandchildren.
I'm trying to do the best I can, which was to write a responsible resolution.
Any plan that doesn't take bold, transformative action is not going to be what we need.
Well, you know better than I do. So I think one day you should run for the Senate.
Great.
And then you do it your way.
But by that time, there's going to be a big problem.
I just won a big election.
And everything's gotten worse the last 4 years, and Democrats won't admit it. And that doesn't help them. Just because they're in charge, they can still admit that things get worse, but they don't. They deny it. But I mean, let's be real. We've had inflation all around, especially with food. Everything that affects the poor, everything that you need to survive, we've seen extreme inflation. Housing. Liberals gave up on both COVID-19 and climate change while using both as partisan wedge issues, claiming to follow the science, while denying the science, not following the science in any case at all. We're still in the fucking pandemic. Fucking climate change is worse than ever. And we know that exporting liquid natural gas, which is what Democrats are relying on when they brag about how we've got record gas production and yet we're reducing emissions. Yeah, it's because we're just fracking the shit, not accounting for it, and sending it overseas, making the money out. We are the heroin dealer that has gone clean, partially, and is bragging about it. We want the moral high ground for being the heroin dealer. Like, look, man, I barely do any more heroin.
I'm at 20% of the heroin I used to use. I just sell heroin to the masses. But now I'm making so much money. But heroin's a bad thing. Like, huh? Like, these motherfuckers.
If you're feeling anxious about the end of the world, just picture perpetual genocide and presidential elections like this every 4 years forever. And you'll feel much better about the end of all things.
And on top of it, Democratic cities and states got Governor Newsom out there demolishing a homeless encampment. Like, with his own fucking two bare soft fucking hands. And where honestly, if we had a real president, dude, send Joe Biden, dude, tell him that was fucking corn pop. Gavin Newsom's corn pop, dude, go knock him out. Literally, that motherfucker should have been laid out in that, on his fucking publicity stunt demolishing a homeless encampment. This is insane. And they're doing this all over the country in Democratic cities, Democratic states, doesn't matter. It's a war on the homeless happening under Biden, under a Democratic administration, under the Biden-Harris administration, and under the Biden-Harris administration. We've seen Roe versus Wade was overturned, so the federal right to abortion overturned, right on the heels of the co-opting of the Black Lives Matter movement by the Democratic Party. 2023, we saw a record number of murders by police. Inequality worse than ever. AI coming for jobs, climate goals. Under Biden, we saw the first assassination on U.S. soil by police of an environmentalist. Tortuguita in Atlanta, Cop City. Murdered by police. Historic assassination by police. I mean, there should have been a Department of Justice investigation, but we don't have a real fucking presidency who gives a shit. Biden didn't, I don't think Biden could even pronounce Tortuguita. He doesn't give a shit. And yet he could have said something and changed the whole dynamic. Let me, like, from on the ground here, like, Biden saying something even could have changed the whole dynamic early in the game. And now at this point, yeah, we've reached history where it's okay to just, for police to just murder climate activists. And we know how they think. I'm sorry. Well, if you care, you know how these fucking police think about activists, climate activists. You know, they think about us the way that, you know, Kamala Harris thinks about Palestinians. A nuisance we're supposed to kind of care about. But at the end of the day, we just have to kill. It's our duty. It's our duty. On top of all that, we got the crackdown on free speech on college campuses and workplaces all over, really, over anyone speaking up about the genocide of Palestine. And, you know, really, the list goes on. The past 4 years, shit has been getting worse, just like the 4 years before that. And where are liberals? At brunch, of course, still at brunch, mentally at least. Democratic voters are in like a zombie mode, 100% in a zombie mode. Like, this partisan politics has broken them. This tribalism of party politics has fucked up the minds of Democratic Party voters, like, especially the most fervent ones. If you're just a passive voter and you just go vote, that's one thing. But the party insiders, the people who are really the most involved, they have been so emotionally invested in this campaign, which is ultimately defending a genocide in the status quo that we all know is unsustainable and totally fucked, and moving to the right, this whole strategy of moving to the right for the Democratic Party. This is what this campaign is a referendum on. This campaign is a referendum on. This election is a referendum on the strategy of moving to the right. This campaign, this election is a referendum on this genocide. Calling Democrats Blue MAGA at this point is totally appropriate. They are a mirror reflection, a total doppelganger of what they hated in Trump and MAGA and Red MAGA. They've become the exact same unthinking zombies, just shilling for a party and a candidate, not caring at all about the ethics or the reality involved. And that's why climate change is such a perfect lens to just distill all this through, because you really see who is absolutely full of shit and who is, you know, maybe somehow living on planet Earth.
Insurrection. Noun. An unsuccessful revolution. Disaffection's failure to substitute misrule for bad government. The Devil's Dictionary.
But the Democrats, they've become the patriotic, the Christian, imperialist, the meat-loving, animal-hunting, fracking, pro-war, billionaire-funded, like immigrants, but they'll still deport you, you know, and committed to
a very racist genocide on top of it. This is not where I thought the Democratic Party would be in 2024. Ever in my life. This is crazy. All they care about is winning. But for those of us in reality, it's sorry to say, but it's very real. This is the worst case possibility. This is the worst case scenario. A Harris win, a Democratic Party win, Democrats taking the trifecta could very much be the worst case scenario for humanity that could possibly exist as an outcome of this election. Because telling them that, saying fuck climate science, go commit genocide, join with the Cheneys, basically become the GOP, the old GOP party, the pre-Trump GOP. Having the American government move their lesser evil of two parties from whatever the fuck they used to be, opposition to Cheney and Bush, kinda, when in an election year, this is the fucked up thing. Is like once you look back, you realize, like, dude, this has always been the Democratic Party. This has always been these motherfuckers. Ever since McGovern, look back at 72. Look back at McGovern. This has always been this party. And they'll still blame it on us. They'll still blame it on the left, no matter what happens. They'll blame the Jill Stein voters. They can't accept any responsibility if they lose. But if they win, fuck you, we never needed you. But if they lose, it's all your fault.
Just a question for Mr. Thompson. In Fear and Loathing 72, your rhetoric was actually much harsher against Hubert Humphrey than against Nixon. I was wondering, is that because Nixon was essentially unavailable, or your expectations for the Democrats were so much greater?
I think it was because I was offended more by Humphrey's treachery than I was by Nixon's pure evil.
Thing here, though, is that how far-right Democrats have moved on foreign policy. It's absolutely insane. I mean, I don't think George W. Bush would have done something as insane as accept this genocide of Gaza by Israel and expanding into Lebanon. And of course, the West Bank. I mean, it's pretty clear at this point, like, Palestine's gone. Fuck. Palestine. And I always kind of expected this, but it's like, it's another thing to fucking see it. And then to see Democrats, fully supporting it full-throatedly. I mean, that's the darkest sign. Like, these are some fucking dark times coming up on us as a species. And to say that there's light at the end of the tunnel, anyone who tells you that shit, tell them to fuck off. They're trying to sell you something. That's bullshit. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. If it is, it's a radioactive flame.
How do you comment on the fact that Israel has passed laws that outlaw a UN organization? Because other member states who have even a worse record than Israel could do the same. Human rights record than Israel could do the same. How do I comment the fact that Israel there has been a plan to erase Palestinian presence from northern Gaza, and the fact that Israel is freely talking about going back to Gaza and reoccupy Gaza, while the International Court of Justice has recognized that the occupation is illegal and must go unequivocally and totally. This is what I want to talk about.
So this is exactly what I'm talking about. This is a dark turn. I mean, under a Democratic administration, we've totally trashed international law. So if Trump becomes president, he's going to have that precedent set for him. So thanks for laying the groundwork for genocide forever, Democrats. I mean, if Democratic voters had spent the last year as fervently anti-genocide as they are today, November 4th, fervently pro-Harris, the genocide would have been stopped months ago. Democratic voters are more opposed to Trump than they are opposed to committing a genocide. So now, not only has the genocide continued, but it makes winning certain demographics in states like Michigan increasingly unlikely. Though we'll see tomorrow. Committing a genocide of Arabs and Muslims might pick up Democrats some votes in some other states. But, there's another side of the dark side of all of this. This really is normalizing modern genocide and even rewarding it politically if Democrats win at this point. I mean, that's as dark a turn as just dark. As global warming and ecological collapse add increasing stressors to our whole civilization and species, and now we're normalizing genocide, like, this is not good.
Everything is burning
As I watch the video, she crawls out of the ruins, venturing to go out in search of water, the final human need. Although the consequences are almost guaranteed, as she goes out in the open beneath the killer drones, which aims their sights on her, then shred her to the bones, then waits for any people who might be fool enough to try, come to fetch her body beneath the smoke-filled sky. 2 million people behind the ghetto wall wait for 2-ton bombs to fall, to crush and burn the schools and tents where your whole extended family went. Scores more murdered with each passing day, with so many more on the edge of being taken away. Surrounded by tanks that fire at will, and the rest of the world stands by still. Completely surrounded with no food getting in, ghost-like faces impossibly thin, kids that look like babies, babies bored, thirsty, starving, and forlorn, and being taken to who knows where, the elderly, the children, the wounded in chairs, with donkey carts and wagons south on cue, as the drones above the rubble order them to do. They're carrying out the general's plan, which means kill all the kids that you possibly can. Anyone moving, soldiers take aim. Who they are doesn't matter, they're all the same. Make no distinctions, orders decree. Killing them all is just how it must be. And right now in New Jersey, you can buy shares in the resort Jared Kushner plans to build there.
On top of just the policies that they perpetuate, that, you know, the problem is what this election's done to the U.S. electorate. The way that we've been, if Americans do elect Kamala Harris, and if this election goes through smoothly, I mean, if there's, you know, ever another president of the United States again after Joe Biden's corpse, maybe he'd appropriately be the final president.
Remember the 5th of November.
You know, if Harris wins. You know, the worst part isn't just the policy, because maybe Trump would be just as bad on foreign policy and probably worse on most domestic policies. And this is a whole conversation, but Democrats would fucking love to argue with any fucking suggestion that they might not be total pieces of shit just as much as Republicans are. You know, they would never want to admit that, even as they brag about having the Cheneys on their side.
What kind of clown show universe?
You know, ignoring all the policy potential differences, just telling Democratic Party voters that overlooking genocide is okay, Democratic Party voters telling our political system that overlooking genocide is okay for the lesser evil party, that is a dark move. That is a dark move for America, for humanity. I mean, what's more American than genocide? Name something. Apple pie, that's a close second. Donald Trump, that's a close third. But no, there's nothing really more American than genocide. I mean, we inspired Hitler. You know, Hitler, he got the ideas that put him in the history books from us.
Oh, do they know future? Oh, they know
future. What should be one of the biggest fears over this election is that our politicians of the lesser evil party realize that certain groups of people will always be considered expendable. And this is going to be a big problem going forward. Because right now, we can just look over the Palestinians, and it's easier for everyone to look over Gazans and just say, oh, they're whatever the fuck, you know, the classic excuses. All the classic dehumanizing excuses. I don't need to run through them. But basically, they're not worthy of the same moral concern as me, basically. But that's also just going to be a prototype. I mean, Gaza's just a prototype for the outgroup. The perpetual outgroup going forward. And this is, I don't think Israel thinks of this. I don't think our own politicians even think of this. As climate and ecological collapse break down our entire civilization, there are going to be more and more increasingly marginalized, massive groups of people.
And in one way or another, thanks to climate and ecological collapse, we're going to be fighting over fewer and fewer resources.
Politics. Noun. A strife of interests masquerading as a contest of principles. The conduct of public affairs for private advantage. The Devil's Dictionary.
Michelle Obama was speaking at a Kamala Harris rally recently and was talking about voters throwing women and girls under the bus.
Let's not forget that her husband was first elected promising to codify Roe versus Wade.
And this is as her party is complicit in this genocide and absolutely necessary every day for its continuation. I mean, if Biden said today he's going to stop every single, he's going to do a total arms embargo on Israel, the genocide would stop. It would slow down tonight. It would very much slow down tomorrow. Give it 2-3 days, and it would basically stop. It would basically, they'd be running on fumes for 3 days. And yet, these same Democrats are going to want to guilt trip you on these same grounds. They're going to want to say, you know, don't throw rights for someone else under the bus. Throw rights for someone else under the bus. Like, what? We're literally like, you know how many women and girls have been slaughtered, raped, traumatized, all kinds, dismembered by billions of dollars of bombs sent by a Democratic president in the past year? And we're supposed to just drive the bus over their body parts, right? Right, Michelle? We're just going to drive the bus right over all those bodies. That's fine. Because why? Because they're not American, I guess. I don't know. Because they're not white? Because they're not Christian? I don't know what it is. I don't know. Maybe Michelle Obama could clarify, but she only hits the public from her environmentally illegal beachfront mansion once every 4 years when Democrats are in fucking full panic mode. You know, this under-the-bus politics is what we should always expect from the lesser evil voting paradigm that we're stuck in. This is what we need to expect from collapse, and we need to strategize knowing that. We can't just be at the whim of every single time when they say, oh my God, we're the lesser evil. And, oh my God, you're just going to put women and children under the bus. It's like, wait a minute. You're driving the bus. What do you mean? What do you mean I'm throwing them under the bus? You're driving the bus. I mean, honestly, at this point, politics is so fucking broken. It feels like it seems like the usefulness of it is over. Usefulness of it to mitigate whatever horror societal and civilizational collapse is going to be as we totally destroy our biosphere and climatological system and totally throw our civilization outside of the bounds that it can sustain. You know, politics is the big force. People wonder why do you care about politics? Why are you focusing on all this partisan bullshit when you know it's all bullshit? Well, it's because this is the 800-pound gorilla at the end of the day. You can go hide in your mountaintop or whatever, but guess what, dude? It'd take, you know, if the government wants to send a tiny portion of their assault rifle robot dogs up your mountaintop, guess what, dude? Your whole little environmentalist commune on the mountaintop you thought was so safe and so self-sustainable is going to be gone. Like, this is the 800-pound gorilla. The political system is the 800-pound gorilla, and yet it seems so hopeless. Even under Democrats, we're doing this. We're practicing on Gazans what they're going to be doing here. In very short order, and we know this. We should have known this. This wasn't fucking Black Mirror. And now they're sending these dogs to train on Arabs because they're not real people. So we're going to train on them before we set them loose in America to have these, you know, our robot assault rifle dogs and quadcopters with guns gunning people down like they're doing in Gaza. You know, they send drones to hunt people in Gaza now. It's absolutely fucking, and to terrorize them. It's the most fucked up, insane dystopia, and it's coming for everybody. Everyone wants to act like they're safe from it. So the elephant-sized pile of child corpses in the room. Yes, what we all want to ignore until after Election Day. And then we can care so much or so little or whatever, and it's complicated and it's nuanced. Whatever excuse you want, doesn't matter. At the end of the day, all that the system cares about is how you turn out on Election Day, on voting. You know, pull that red or that blue lever. Don't pull a lever. Pull the green lever. That's all they care about. And if you're a person of conscience, they want to guilt trip you into pulling the blue lever. And if you're not, then guilt trip's not going to work very well, is it? At this point. No, they're going to want to hate trip you into pulling the red lever. And it's the same fucking lever, isn't it? Really seems like it. I mean, the next 4 years are going to be a fucking nightmare, no matter who wins. It's undeniable at this point. It's going to be such a nightmare, and you just need to be ready for it. get a dark sense of humor. Internalize your dark sense of humor so that you just laugh at the dark shit. But don't, not in a, you don't want a gallows humor like where you're happy to be the executioner. You want a dark humor like you have empathy and yet you see the absurdity of all the insane psychopathic evil we unleash unnecessarily upon ourselves as a species. Oh, this shit's gonna suck no matter what. There's no good outcome. There's no good possibility coming from this election. I don't know. We might not even have another president. Who knows what the fuck's gonna happen? I mean, at this point, hopefully I'll never talk about electoral politics again. This is probably the last election in the United States of America, so it's a new dawn, though. Another few countries and wild wastelands will grow from your corpse and... another day. It's election day in this disintegrating union, so get out and vote, or don't. It doesn't seem to matter much, does it?
Nothing.
Thank God and all our sponsors, Alan Gloss Band, the Red Party Fundraising Committee, the Blue Party Fundraising Committee, Taggart Industries, Golden Apple Technologies, Duct Tape, Satan himself, Ghost Dome, Rich Kids of the World, Guy Fox, David Graeber, Exxon, Volta, APEC, the Air Control Institute, the Wayne Corporation, the Utonic Corporation, the Trade Federation, countless small donors and listeners, but most importantly, all the super donors and oil and gas companies, and Barack Obama, and Joe Biden, and Donald Trump, and Kamala Harris, there could be no end of the world. There could be no end of the world. Thank you the most. We'll be back for the next election. Even though there probably won't be another one. So actually, this is probably the last one. Sorry about that. In which case, good luck and smile for the end of the world. No matter who wins, party time! Fuck.
Oh, rest in peace, America.